Hello, class. Good afternoon. Sorry, I come online late. It's due to network issues. And I can't see any of you online presently. But that notwithstanding, I'll go ahead to treat the topic for today's online facilitation. For today, we want to discuss the hardware components of the computer system. And as we all know, we have the hardware components, the input devices, the output devices, the storage devices, and the central processing unit itself. The input devices are the devices through which you get your data and your instructions to be executed into the computer, while the output devices are the devices through which you get the results of your processing out of the computer. Then the storage devices are the devices on which you store data and instructions that you want the system to work on. Then we have the central processing unit itself, which is the main machine of the computer that takes care of all the activities that signifies processing, need arithmetic instructions, logic instructions, even storage instructions, instructions that, okay, you should store this data into this device or into this memory of the computer. They are still all part of the processing. So now we go to the input devices. The input devices, I believe all of you, one way or the other, you have come across, you have been in touch with a computer before, and if not, the most basic of all your, or the most popular these days of all your, of all computers, is the, your handset. On your handset, even when you are using touch screen, you will have a keyboard, whether virtual on your handset. If you are not using touchscreen, you will have real keyboard that will be part of your handset. So now when we talk about the computer keyboard, is identical to your conventional typewriter. We call it QWERTY typewriter in those days. It's identical to your typewriter. And the computer keyboard is considered to be intelligent if, in addition to performing the routine functions characteristics of the typewriter keyboard, it can initiate a series of actions for a computer to carry out by mere pressing a key or combination of two or more keys. For instance, when you press the combination of your control key and the letter B key, then any text that you have highlighted in your word processing package will be bold. So the computer keyboard is also said to be intelligent. So on your computer keyboard, in addition to the, we have four types of key that are on your computer keyboard. We have the function keys, and on your computer keyboard, you will see that your function keys are on the uppermost row of your keyboard. The function keys are on the uppermost row of your keyboard. And then you have the alphanumeric keys, as the name implies, alphanumeric keys means both alphabetic keys and numeric keys. That is the place where you have your letters and your numbers. Then you have the numeric keys. If you look, the center of your keyboard is the alphanumeric key. Under, you know, the function keys are the uppermost one. Under the function key, you have the numbers 1 to 0. So those are the numeric keys up there. Then after that, you have your letters. So the center of the keys on the center, at the center of your keyboard are called after alphanumeric, because you have the numeric keys as well as the alphabetic keys there. Then you have the numeric keys. Though I will tell you that it is not all computers. It is not all computers that still have the numeric keypad aside from the alphanumeric keys. But like the one I'm using now, if it is possible to place my camera on it, you will have seen that I have my numeric keypad at the right-hand corner. At the right hand corner of my keyboard. So that is the numeric key. And in order to use the numeric keys there, you have what we call numlock. Numlock is to when your numlock is on, then whatever you press on that, your numeric keys will be numbered. But when the numlock is off, then the keys there are combined with control keys. They are combined with control. When the numlock is not on, then when you press it, it is the control keys like the home, the page up, the arrow keys, the end key, the page down keys that will be depressed there. So in addition to these four types of keys, four categories of keys that are on your keyboard, there are some special or important keys, such as the return key or enter key. We have the return key or the enter key. We have the escape key at the upper leftmost corner of your keyboard, where you have your function keys. The first key at the left hand side there, it is written ESC, is the escape key. And you have the key, the control key, denoted by the CTRL. And you have the alternate key. On that key, you will see written there, ALT, ALT. Then you have the delete key. And that is at the end of your function keys on the uppermost row of your keyboard. You have the function, you have the delete key. And then you have the insert key also. The insert key is on the left, on the last row of your right hand corner, where you have your numeric key. That is where you see your insert key, and the inscription on it is INS. Then you have the backspace key, and you might want to ask me what is the difference between the delete key and the backspace key. The delete key deletes letters or symbols to the right of your cursor, whereas your backspace key deletes to the back, as in to the leftmost, to the left corner, to the left hand side of your cursor key. Then you have the shift key also. The shift key, when you press the shift key on its own, you don't see anything. There is no action. But when you press the shift key in combination with some other keys, for instance, if I want to press the capital letters of the alphabetic keys, once I press the shift key in combination with that particular letter, then I'll have the capital letter of that letter. Or you can press the shift key if you want to type the symbols that is written on top of your numeric keys. Like if you want to type equal to ampersand, percentage, and so you press the shift key in combination with that key, and you have that. Then the function keys now. The effect of the function keys are software package dependent. So it depends on how the developer of the package you are using had programmed that particular key to work. So in some packages, like your Microsoft Word, when you press the F1, you get the help. Like in Microsoft PowerPoint, when you press the F5, then you have your slides, your slideshow. It goes to the slideshow view. So what the function key will do for you is dependent on how the developer of the package you are using has programmed it to work. The function keys are often arranged to the function keys are often arranged to the left key of the main keyboard. And the function key, you have the, traditionally they are labeled F1, F2, F3, up to F12. And the function key F1, like I said before, is used to run help in your Microsoft Word or Word Perfect and so on. And the function key F7 and F12 are used to save a text and block a section of the text respectively in Word Perfect. The function key F10 is the program to display menu. So, the operations of the function key can be determined by the user or programmed by the software package being used at any point in time. Alphanumeric keys. Alphanumeric keys, I have explained that to you. And they are like the conventional typewriter keys. They contain alphabetic characters, numeric characters, and special characters such as your comma, stop, your open bracket, bracket, asterisk, colon, semicolon, apostrophe, hash, and so on. And the shift key is used to switch on the lower or uppercase character, of the by the programmer. Cursor control keys. We have the cursor control keys which are located at the down left corner of your alphanumeric keys, and they are also together with your numeric keypad. So the cursor control keys are what we call the arrow keys, the page up and page down keys, the home key, and the end key. The arrow keys, we have the arrow left, we have the arrow right, we have the arrow up, and we have the arrow down. When you press the arrow up key, control key, move your cursor one line up. It moves your cursor one line up on the page you have. The arrow down key moves your cursor one line down on the page you have. Whereas the arrow right moves your cursor one character to the right. Let's say you have typed something on your keyboard, on your screen. Let's say it is A, B, C in a row like that. If the cursor is on A, once you press the arrow right key, then it moves the cursor to B, to C, and so on. But if it is arrow left, if your cursor is on B, when you press it to the left, then it goes to A, and any letters before A. Then the home key on the page, the home key where you have the home key, let's say you are in Microsoft Word environment, you are working on a document. When you are on a particular line and you press the home key, it will take the cursor to the first letter. It will take the cursor to the first insertion point on that line, the leftmost character. That is where it will take the cursor to. But when you press the end key, it moves your cursor to the end of that line. It moves it to the end of that line. Also, it can, in addition to some other keys, the home key can take you to the first line of a page that you are in. and the end key can take you to the last line of the page you are on in a document. The page down key, which is written as PGDN, that is page down, it will move you one page down, like maybe you are on page one. Once you press the page down key, it takes you to page two, and so on, page three, and so on and so forth. But let's say you are on page one, and you now press the page up key, it will not move from where it is because there is no page before page one. But if you are on page 10, for instance, and you press the page up key, then it takes you to page 9. If you press it again, it takes you to page 8, and so on and so forth. Other cursor control keys, as I have explained, are the open, the end, the page up, and the page down. The numeric keypad, I have explained that it is used for typing and entering number digits, and it is from 0 to 9 on the computer. A numeric key is often activated by pressing the num lock key. You have the num lock key on top of the numeric keypad there. And the numeric keypad is also used in combination with Alt key to produce extended characters. When you press the Alt and you now press for instance, if you press the Alt key and you press Home, then it will take you to the first page of your document. If you press the Alt key and you now press end, it will take you to the last page document. That is how that one works. So the Alt key, you can use it in addition to your numeric keys. Type special characters. Type special characters. Then we have the shift key, like I have explained before. Your shift on its own. Your shift key on its own does not do anything. If you press the shift key alone, your document, you cannot see any, you cannot see manifestation of anything. But when you press it in addition, when you press it in addition, in combination, if you press it in combination with your alphabetic keys, if your caps lock is not on, there's a key on your keyboard that is called caps lock. When you put on the caps lock, anything you will type, any alphabet you will type on your keyboard will be in capitals. And if the caps lock is on and you press your shift key in combination with that letter, then you have the lowercase of that letter. But if the caps lock is not on, you can press your shift key and that letter to get the uppercase of the letter. So let's say you want to type everything you want to type all in capitals, then you simply press your caps lock key and you continue typing and everything will be in capital. So the control key now, the control key is often used in most modes to perform block operations like mass deletion, mass insertion, and so on. For instance, if you press control key together with the Y key, it deletes a line in most text documents, including your Microsoft Word. So if you press your control key in combination with Y, then with the letter Y key, then it deletes a line. So your control key, for instance, if you select some text in your document and you press your control key together with the letter B key, then it will be bolding. If you press the control key together with the letter I key, then it will italize your text for you. If you press the control key in combination with the letter U key, then it will underline your text for you. Then we have the escape key. The escape key is to is pressed in order to escape from the present operation, to cancel the present operation that is in progress, or to get out of a particular menu. Escape cancels all changes that might have made or terminate the command. Then we have the return key, which is also called the enter key. The enter key, when you are in a, let's say, document environment, when you press the enter key, it takes you to the next line. It takes you to the next line. It inserts a line onto your document. When you are selecting something, like maybe you want to select a menu, by putting your cursor on that menu or icon and you press the enter key, then it will load that program. For instance, if you want to load a Microsoft Word, for instance, and you have the icon on your desktop, by just putting your cursor on that and you now press the enter key, it will launch that application for you. So that is the enter key and the return key. The insert key, which on it you will see as INS, the insert key, what you use it to do is, when the insert key is pressed, then you type over. When the insert key is pressed, you type over anything that you have typed before. Let's say I have typed Afolorunsho is a woman, and I now press the insert key, and I now put my cursor at the beginning where Afolorunsho is start from, and I now start typing. I now start typing Adenrele is a girl. It will delete, or it will type over. That is, it will replace Afolorunsho is a woman with whatever I am typing presently. But if the insert key is not on, and you put your cursor at the beginning of that Afolorunsho is a woman and you start typing, it will just be displaying what you are typing afresh and be pushing Afolorunsho is a woman to the right of the line you have. So that is the insert key. And I have explained the key, delete key. That one deletes characters to the right of your cursor, whereas the backspace key, the light delete character to the left of your cursor. We have the space bar key, which you use to insert a space between words that you are typing, space between the characters that you are typing. And we have the tab key. The tab key, depending on how you set it, the tab key is used to insert several blank spaces into your document. And we have the print screen. The print screen, when you press the print screen, it will, like where I am now, if I just press the print screen, then it will screenshot what is on my monitor, what is displayed on my monitor presently. Just like when you are using your phone and say you want to screenshot, you want to take a picture of what is displayed on your screen. So that is the same function that your print screen is doing. So it is equivalent to screen shooting on your phone. So when you print screen, you press the print screen key, then it captures what is displayed currently on your monitor. So the keyboard, you need to keep your keyboard clean. Don't put any liquid near your keyboard. You can't allow dust to settle on it so that the keys will function properly, so that it is not that when you want to press A, you will see that A, letter A is not displaying again. Then other types of, I have treated the keyboard because it is the most basic. It is the most basic of all input devices in the computer. Computer without keyboard. The keyboard might not be physical, it might be virtual, like the one on your touch screen phone. At the time you say you want to text, it will bring up the keyboard for you. There is no computer system without a keyboard. Then we have the mouse. I believe next to the mouse you have your you have your mouse. That is the second most popular, and then you use your mouse to select input into your computer. So you use your mouse to click, like if it gives you a virtual keyboard, like in instance, if you are working with virtual keyboard, then you can use your mouse to click on the letters on the virtual keyboard and just continue typing. So all modern PCs has a mouse, whether it is inbuilt like in your laptop or it is attached to it. You have the joystick and other means. Your joystick can be compared to the stylus attached to your phone. And we have the devices. And now devices, like I said before, are the means through which you get your stuff from the computer. And the most basic of all the output units is your monitor. Your monitor screen. Monitor of your computer system. That is the most basic of all. That is the most basic of all output devices. I am yet to see a computer without a monitor, without a screen, through which you will be seeing what is going on in your system. And we all know what the monitor is. In those days, we used to have the ones that look like the CRT tube, the cathode ray tube, but now we have gone to flat screen. And now I believe our monitor works on a LED device, like without the devices. So it is through the monitor that you see what's going on. Even when you put your computer on and it is booting, it is through the monitor that you monitor the progress of what is going on in your computer. Even when you are typing, it is through the monitor that you see the outcome of what I am typing. And the internal process, what your computer is working on recently, is displayed for you. So it is after you see it that you can now send it to other output devices like your printer. Maybe you want to have a physical copy. Of your documents that you can show the outcome of the process. You can now send it to the printer to print. You can send it to your external storage flash or whatever, so that you have the soft copy of it. And the printer all computer systems. So a printer is a computer component that lets you create copies of the information stored on your computer. It's called the soft copy. And when you put it on a storage device, it is still referred to as the soft copy. But by the time you print on paper, even when you burn it on CD, it is still soft copy. But by the time you put it on paper, then it is called hard copy. The printed copy is referred to as hard copy. And we have different types of printer. We have the laser printer. We have the inkjet printer. And we have the dot matrix printer. Only I am not sure that the dot matrix printer is still in the market now. But in those days, we know what we call the dot matrix, which is an impact printer. It prints character by character. It was after the dot matrix printer that the line printers that will print one line at a time was invented. Then we have the laser printer, which prints one page at a time. Then the inkjet printers are there, which you use to print colors. So the print quality, the quality of what you print depends on the technology of your printer. And you also have the plot, the graph plotters that you use to plot graphs and whatever. And your monitor, there are different kinds of monitor, just like your television at home. You have a 60-inch, 72-inch, 100-inch. So in a monitor also, you have different kinds of inches, and you have different kinds of technology. You have the VGA, you have the SVGA, and so on. Then we have the scanners. The scanners are peripheral devices which is used to digitize your artwork, that is to convert your work into electronic format, like a text, your photograph, and other items from hard copy. So you have a document like this paper. You have this paper in, you have this as a hard copy which I have been given. I now want to put what is here without typing it, and with all this, you can look at this document with all this logo and the stamp of when the memo was received. I want everything to be exactly represented on my computer. And to send it exactly like this to somebody, then I can use my scanner to scan this document. So that means this hard copy has become digitized, so I will now have it in a soft copy. And we have different types of scanners. We have the flatbed scanners, we have the sheet fed scanners, and we have the hand scanners. The flatbed scanners, they look and behave a lot like a photocopier. You lay the items to be scanned on a glass plate, and the scanning head passes through the glass, just like the one we have in our office here. And the flatbed scanners are very versatile, and they can scan objects in a variety of sizes, shapes, including pages from a book, without damaging the original. Flatbed scanners are the best choice for a wide variety of uses. And if you plan to do a lot of text scanning, that is optical character recognition work, must have a flatbed. You must have a flatbed scanner. You have to have it in mind that it can only give you one page at a time. So if you have a multiple page that runs into thousands and very tedious using flatbed scanner. Then we have the sheet fed scanners. The sheet fed scanners look and act more like a fax machine. The page or item is fed into the machine and scanned, then spit out on the other hand. The sheet fed scanner is a good choice for large volume of text, but not for handling delicate original documents like photographs and text. Scanning directly from a book for other three-dimensional things is impossible. So you cannot feed a whole textbook into it. Then we have the stickers and fans. The stickers are also output devices. Stickers are output devices. It is through the stickers that you hear voices on the computer. That you can get a voice output from the computer. So, so that is all about the hardware of the computer. But apart from all these ones that I have discussed, what is called auxiliary equipment that you use in your computer environment, and then this auxiliary equipment, they are not that necessary, but for the convenience of the user, they are important. So the auxiliary equipment include your air conditioner. Thank God for the advancement in technology, and we don't have so big computer systems before, like before. In those days, you have all these big computer systems that will even occupy a whole room, and maybe combination of two rooms together. And those computers, they dissipate a lot of heat. And wherever you put them, you need to air condition the place so that the computer will not malfunction. Because when the computer gets too hot, then it begins to malfunction. When the computer gets too hot, it begins to malfunction, like I said before. So, for instance, even this, our laptop, from my own personal experience, I have seen that if you are on the battery of your laptop, you are in an air-conditioned room, you see that your battery will not drop suddenly. If your battery is giving you 4 hours, it says it will last 4 hours. When you are in an air-conditioned room and you are using it normally, not that you are using it for video or music, it will last that 4 hours. But you are in a hot environment. If you are in a hot environment where there is no AC, even though your battery is saying 4 hours and you are not even on video or anything that can really drain your battery like that, the battery gets drained easily. It gets drained easily in hot weather. But if it's in cool weather, then the battery will last as long as you want it to last. So that is the air condition. Also, we have the voltage stabilizer so that you will not have a power surge that can damage your hardware. You can get a voltage stabilizer. We have the environment in Nigeria where we have that electric power is not stable. So, you invest on a UPS. You invest on UPS so that whatever we are working on, and like we have treated, you know that your RAM, that is your read access, anything that you work on it, there is power outage, you use that data, or whatever the outcome of that processing, and you have to restart again. But with that means we have time. The UPS will give you some minutes to round up properly down your system. This year, especially if you are working on a desktop, if it is a laptop, you know that your laptop has battery, so it will still give you time to round up what you are doing. If you are working on a desktop, it is good for you to invest on a UPS so that you do not lose your data, you do not lose the result of your processing once there is a power. So that we have come to the end of what I want us to talk today. Next class, next week, we'll be discussing that next week. So the time left now, we want to have an interaction. If you have any questions you want to ask, feel free to ask. If you have anything you want us to discuss now, Hello. Any questions? Hello. Oh.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah, I can hear you.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, dear.
Not hearing anyone.
I'm hearing you. I'm hearing you. Whether you ask your question, even if you are not hearing me, ask your question. It will be recorded on this video, and you can go to the recorded video later.
Hello.
Hello.
Amy. Hello.
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 Hello, I'm here.
The network is bad.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. You made mention of air conditioning. Yeah. Does that mean that that guarantees the time that your battery lasts while using it? How?
Yes, it guarantees that your computer will not malfunction. It guarantees that your computer lifespan of your computer will be elongated. It guarantees that your battery will not drain no time. So that is for my all I know is that the work that is different where we have mini computer and where they put that mini computer. The temperature there is so cold that even we have we are going into, and when you bring a hot cup of coffee or tea into that room, within 10 seconds, it will be ice cold. That was the kind of environment where they kept the mini computer in those days. And so that because when your computer is heated up, then it begins to malfunction. But from my own personal experience, my laptop, I know that when I'm in a cool environment and I'm running my laptop on my battery, it lasts longer than if I am in an hot environment.
Hello, ma.
Hello.
Good afternoon, ma.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma. Please, ma, I want to ask concerning the TMA, particularly on this computer fundamental.
Mm-hmm.
I guess is after answering the whole question, both TMA 1, 2, 3, and you participate in the group discussion and the other activities, at the end, you are supposed to have 100%. All this I have done, but I'm having 94%. So I don't know what else to do to make it up to 100%.
You're having what?
I'm having 94% now. I'm having 94% now. It's remaining 6% for it to be up to the 100%. So I don't know what else to do, ma.
Well, just do all that is humanly possible. Maybe your participation in the discussion room has not been frequent. Maybe that is why you have that 94%. It might be that okay, your participation, you are not active enough. But really, just do all that you can do. The people that are working on it, they know what to do. They know why it is like that. and in the way that the system has been programmed to process that and give you your CMA score. And you'll see that your CMA is still going to be, your continuous assessment is still going to be 30% at the end of the day. It is in the exam that you get your 70%. So they know how to
yes.
on whatever you have now to give you your continuous assessment score.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. So, if you guys don't have any other thing, can we end the meeting now?
Thank you.
Have a nice
day. Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
I'll see you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.